Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
One of the scribes came near and heard them disputing with one another. Seeing that Jesus answered them well, he asked him, "Which commandment is the first of all?" Jesus answered, "The first is, 'Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength.' The second is this, 'You shall love your neighbor as yourself.' There is no commandment greater than these." Then the scribe said to him, "You are right, teacher. You have truly said that he is one, and besides him there is no other. And to love him with all the heart, with all the understanding, with all the strength, and to love one's neighbor as oneself. This is much more important than all whole burnt offerings and sacrifices." When Jesus saw that he answered wisely, he said to him, "You are not far from the kingdom of God." After that, no one dared to ask him any question. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Many thanks to our rector for inviting me to preach this morning. It's a kindness to a retired priest like me. Since today is Halloween, which means that tomorrow is the Feast of All Saints, I thought it would be appropriate to say a few words about the lesson from the Old Testament, the Book of Ruth. Because in Old Testament terms, Ruth comes as close to being a saint as there is in Judaism. I also thought I'd like to talk about it because the other day, Mary and I were listening to the president making a speech at Scranton. He likes to talk about his family. And he mentioned that when he was young, his grandfather had once said to him, "Joey," he said, "you're defined by your courage, and you're redeemed by your loyalty." Good words. And so, since the Book of Ruth is about loyalty and courage and kindness, it fits in today. Also, this scripture has meant a great deal to Jews over the centuries. And it's a story that has also been much cherished by the church. Ruth is the eighth book of the Bible. We call it a book, but it isn't a proper book at all. It's only four short chapters long, which is less than four pages in my Bible. It's so short that if you were thumbing through the Old Testament looking for it, even if you knew that it's right there between Judges and 1 Samuel, you could easily go right past it. The shortness makes it nice to read. But another nice thing is that it's a story. So it's something a person might enjoy reading at home. It has a good plot, and it even has some romance in it. Not steamy romance exactly, but romance that's a little more explicit than you'd expect in the Bible. We're given the first 18 verses of chapter 1 today. And next week, we'll have bits of chapters 3 and 4. So because it's chopped up that way, the story gets somewhat lost. So here it is in a nutshell. There was a famine in Bethlehem in Judah, and a man called Elimelech, who lived there, took his wife Naomi. sons to live in Moab over on the other side of the Dead Sea. But then he died. The two sons married Moabite women, whose names were Orpah and Ruth. And then both the sons died. So Naomi and her daughters-in-law, Orpah and Ruth, were left in Moab as widows. Three women without protection. No father, no husbands, no sons, and no food. Then Naomi heard that the famine back in Bethlehem had ended. So she decided to return alone, and she urged Orpah and Ruth to go back to their Moabite families. Orpah went, but Ruth was loyal to Naomi and refused to leave her to face an uncertain future alone. So the two of them, Ruth and Naomi, left Moab and went to Bethlehem. Naomi had a prominent kinsman in Bethlehem called Boaz. Boaz heard of Ruth's faithfulness to Naomi and admired her for it. So first he showed kindness to Ruth, allowing her to glean in his fields and giving her food to take home. Later he married her and they had a child called Obed. So Obed became the father of Jesse, and Jesse became the father of David the king. Everybody loves this story. It's beautifully written. It's charming. It's short. The characters are all praiseworthy, and there's really no hint of moralizing. As I said, Ruth is as close to a saint as there is in Judaism. The story moves from tragedy to a happy ending in Bethlehem that results from consistent faithfulness and family loyalty. To Jews, it's especially important because it provides a genealogy of David the king. You can't have someone like King David without knowing where he comes from. It's also important because, of course, Ruth is a Gentile, a Moabite. Jews almost always lived in close proximity to other people, and so intermarriage between Jews and Gentiles was common. But it was always controversial. Just read the prophets Ezra and Nehemiah on that subject. Now in the church, this story has been cherished, treasured from the beginning, for all the same reasons, and for other reasons as well. One is very obvious, and that is that since Ruth was an ancestor of David, she was also an ancestor of our Lord, which is mentioned in the genealogies in chapter 3 of Luke and chapter 1 of Matthew. It was also important to the early church that Ruth was a Gentile, but for a different reason. To the church, it means that Gentiles, all Gentiles everywhere, are acceptable to God and therefore totally welcome in the church. You might think that would go without saying, that it would be automatic, but it wasn't. You may remember that St. Paul had to fight with St. Peter to establish this in the early church. There was a whole faction of the early church that resisted the membership of Gentiles. Read the second chapter of Galatians. And then besides that, this story shows that not only did God in Christ come to bring salvation to Gentiles as well as Jews, he came to us as a Jew who had a Gentile ancestor, Ruth the Moabite. The church loves that. Two other things, and these are really important. themes, the central figures are all women. This is an intentional message to a male-dominated culture. Naomi is depicted here as a good person, faced with a very difficult situation, in a culture that offered little or no help. When she decided to return to Bethlehem, her first thought was the safety and well-being of her daughters-in-law. She faced the problems of lack of food and protection with courage and loving concern for Orpah and Ruth. She was willing to send them back to their families to face her own and to face her own uncertain future alone. You may have noticed that Naomi urges Orpah and Ruth to return not to their father's house, but to their mother's house, which is a very proto-feminist thought indeed to have in the Old Testament. For their part, the daughters-in-law return the loyalty and affection with courage. This is a story about the faithfulness, the loyalty of women. And to those patriarchal Jews, the story brought this notion into their sacred literature as something good and holy about David's family history. To Christian people, it suggests maybe something more, something good and holy about the church itself. Mary and I have belonged to the Episcopal Church all our lives. And I tell you that I have never, ever belonged to a parish or served in one in which there were not Ruths and Naomis who kept it going. Everybody knows that's true. Men certainly do their part. Absolutely. But all the time I was growing up, my whole adult life, my active ministry, it was faithful women who were the backbone of the congregations. Always the men in the pulpit, always the men at the altar. And it was a good day for the church when that changed. So that's another thing about the story of Ruth that makes this book cherished in the church. It's a book about the kindness and loyalty of women. Finally, there are those beautiful words that are so well known even by people who've never read this little book. Ruth's answer when Naomi urges her to return to her Moabite family. Ruth says, no, she is bound to Naomi and will not leave her to face the future alone. She will not budge. Some of the most beautiful words spoken in all of literature. You and I are bound together, she says, and I will never leave you. Entreat me not to leave you, or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go. Where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, thy God, my God. Where thou diest, will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord, so do so to me, and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. Absolutely immortal words of love and loyalty and courage. And I think these words are so important because in everyone's life there come moments when we're tempted to be disloyal to someone or something to which we have committed ourselves. It may have come to some people during the pandemic that staying home on Sunday morning is easier than getting dressed up and going to church. Sometimes we're tempted to do something we know our Lord would not approve of. And sometimes people who are committed to Christ have moments when we waver, when we aren't sure just how committed we are. And at such times, a little inspiration, a good good example. It's a fine thing for us. There she is. Ruth the Moabite, this little book. Ancestor of our Lord, ancestor of David the King. No, she says, I will be faithful. I will be loyal. May the Lord do so to me and more also, if aught but death part thee and me. What a good story, the eve of all saints.